Hi, everybody.
Hi, gang. Can you guys, is these, are we live? Oh, there it is.
Oh, you're live, buddy.
Hey.
Hello.
Today is the day we got the really sick mixtape.
Hello.
Hey, hey. Hello, hello.
Thank you.
Great job.
I know.
What's up? Nice to see you.
Hi, Becky. Okay.
Great. Let's take a seat and get started. Also, when we're done, I'm going to ask everyone to stay seated. We have a busy day ahead of us, so we're gonna ask you to stay seated while we clear the room. Let's start with, let's start with voice IDs. So starting in the front row, if I can ask each of you to say your name and then your character's name or your role related to creating the movie.
RJ Kyler, I play Billy Cranston, the Blue Ranger.
I'm Naomi Scott, I play Kimberly Hart.
The Pink Ranger.
You didn't, yeah.
I'm Dacre Montgomery, I play Jason, the Red Power Ranger.
I'm Becky G, and I play the Yellow Ranger, Trini.
I'm Ludi Lin, and I play Zack, the Black Ranger.
John Gatins, screenwriter, executive producer.
I'm Bill Hader, I play Alpha 5.
I'm Elizabeth Banks, I play Rita Repulsa.
Dean Israelite, the director.
Yeah.
Well, first I want to say,
Mic check one, two.
Sibilance.
I just want to congratulate all of you. This is so much fun. Fun.
Yeah.
And I can only imagine how much fun you had doing the film. But I want to ask all of our young actors here, in addition to the fun, you've got a lot, this is very stunt heavy, fight choreography, and underwater sequencing. Can each of you talk about the training that you had to go through to get physically conditioned for the role, and particularly those long underwater sequences?
Well, I guess I'm first. we all trained in our prospective living environments, I guess you can say. I trained at 8711 with, also Becky trained at 8711 too. And then it was just mostly physical training and then also stunt training, which consists of being able to respect distances and also knowing that your partner in this scene is your partner, and both of you guys' safety is, you know, mostly important. So we can keep everybody safe and without bloody noses. And then we got to Vancouver post-production, and then we trained for choreography, and then our stunt team was really good. And so they made us safe and made us feel safe doing our stunts, even though harnesses are still one of the most uncomfortable things known to man.
That's very true.
Yeah.
I think what's interesting about the fact that we trained, I mean, you know, Becky and I, we trained before we actually got to Vancouver. But it was, I think it was more to do with the stamina to actually get through the shoot. It's more for us and to be strong. I don't think it was necessarily purely an aesthetic thing. It wasn't like, oh, you need to be, at the end of the day, we are, you know, playing teenagers in school. And I think it's important that, I mean, not every teenager looks like Ludi Lin, but, you know.
That's because Ludi Lin is not a teenager.
One can only dream.
No, one else of that.
Take off your shirt!
But, you know, we can only try. So I think that was really important that we, and, you know, Becky and I talked about, especially just for us as girls, like we wanted to be normal girls in high school.
We wanted to look real. Yeah.
Well, I wanted to look ripped as possible. No, it was a lot of fun. I didn't come from a sports or physically fit background, I guess. And spending 2.5 months in Perth training in the lead up to shooting was amazing. And I learned so much about my body and my flexibility and my diet. And the stamina to go through the shoot, but also to learn how to be safe on set. And the choreography and the stunts was so important.
Definitely. I think we should take a moment of silence as well for all the teenage girls that fainted every time they posed a selfless, shirtless selfie. The boys, me and they actually, yes. At one point, we were going to print out pictures of the boys' six-packs and then take pictures of them and then post them. It was interesting. I mean, I grew up in Inglewood, so the concept of fighting was very natural. Just kidding.
Yeah.
No, it's like RJ said, you know, this person is not your opponent, they're your partner. And so learning to fight for camera and stacking and safety zones, safety boxes, and, you know, announcing, okay, I'm getting on the wires now and I'm heading up. All that was very new, I think, for a lot of us. But yeah, it was so much fun more than anything.
Yeah, for myself, I don't take training as training. It's nothing. It's not something that's hard for me to do. I take it as
clearly
playing. So I can do it all the time. I can do it for, you know, half an hour if I have it. I can do it for 6 hours if you give it to me. But I learned that sometimes I overplay and I overtrain. And I believe the first day on set when we did some camera tests, they had a problem with my man arms because I obviously overplayed those too much.
Yeah.
But then I learned through training on this show that
I have that problem all the time.
When I think about man arms, I think about
Bill
Hader. That
constantly comes up in everything I do.
Totally.
God damn, he has too many amazing man arms.
He's training all 6 hours.
God damn it, you can do it for 6 hours or 30 minutes.
Yeah. Hi. Oh,
hello.
Hello. Hello. Okay. I watched the original series religiously when I was a kid, so my childhood is high-fiving me right now.
Hey, high five.
We'll high-five you.
Thank you so much. This is a great take, great version. I love it. So much fun. Now, my question is for Dean and John. You know, what I love about the original series is that it's campy but fun. You know, I know campy doesn't translate really well to the big screen at times, so, but there are purist fans out there. So, you know, when your attempt in rebooting this franchise, as far as design, looks, costumes, tone go, did you have concerns about maybe alienating some of the purist fans? And if so, what are some of your efforts in preventing that from happening?
I mean, I don't know that we were ever... We try to come from it from a place of, listen, I grew up with the show. So it's my childhood too, and that made me feel like I had a true north all the time in terms of what I would call myself a lapsed fan, someone that grew up on it and kind of grew away from it, what I would want to see in a reboot of it. So I just use that kind of as true north, and I've gotten this question a lot about were we nervous when we started to approach it, and honestly, I don't think we let that factor in. I think we were excited to be bold in how we were going to reimagine and reinvent it. And I felt like if we kept the spirit of what the original show was in terms of the feeling, in terms of kind of the warmth and the joy and the heart that I think epitomizes the original show, if we were true to that, then we would have a lot of latitude. So we were just excited about the reimagining and hope that if we did all of that properly and stayed true, that the diehard fans are still going to appreciate it.
Yeah, I mean, the only thing I'll add to that is just to say I think that we wanted to honor both the original series but also try to put it in a world that we thought a young audience could kind of recognize themselves in as well. So.
My question is for the actors up there with the wealth of resources that you have. You have the TV show, and then you also have the script. Did you let the script talk to you, or did you sort of go back and rewatch the show for inspiration,
or
what
yeah.
was it?
Well, I just wanted to say a big thank you to Dean in the studio, because I think there was a huge incentive from the creatives to add our own touch.
Mm-hmm.
I'm a newcomer, so, you know, what do I know? But I think that's pretty fortunate. We're pretty lucky to have had that opportunity to put our own little spice into the roles and bring our own,
yes,
you know, as opposed to it being... Thanks, Dean.
It was my pleasure.
To add to that, me and Nate talk about it a lot, that we kind of made the conscious decision not to revisit those things just because I wanted to take that impression that it first made on me and how it's inspired me and stuck with me and then build off of that. And I think what intrigued me the most when I first had the first conversation about the script and my character with Dean was that although these names may sound familiar, you are meeting our characters for the first time. And it's taking place now in 2017 with really, really relevant and current issues to now, which I think, like John said, a lot of kids can identify themselves with and somehow relate to one of our characters in some kind of way.
Yeah. And also, lastly, I think that for me, I wanted to kind of start afresh. And I think that sometimes, yeah, you can... I don't know. I think that yeah, that's basically it. my mind just went blank. I'm not gonna lie.
No, but you bounce off of that, though.
I grew up with this original Power Rangers series. And when I read the script, it struck me as an origin story of these kids. We get to get deeper into their background. So for the TV series, I found that people had a lot of time to grow to love these characters through each episode, when in the script, you really have to dig deep to make them fall in love and relate to the characters within this movie. What I did, I didn't go back to the original American series, but I did go back to watch a few episodes of the original Super Sentai series from the Japanese TV show, and it was, it just... it kind of inspired me to think about how different things could be, because in that show, everything was
very
different. The Yellow Ranger was a man, right? So it gave me a lot of motivation to actually put my own creativity into these characters rather than, you know, follow some convention or memory.
As a non-fan, I really, really enjoyed it. I thought it was so much fun. Good. And thank you for developing the characters and not just making it about an action movie. So Elizabeth, your Rita is pretty scary. I was surprised how scary she was. She's pretty frightening. When the first images came out, though, there was a lot of criticism about your character, but I think you pulled it off.
Oh, great. Yeah, I didn't read any of that criticism. Okay. So I was totally...
What was it? Tell us. What was it?
Yeah, what did they
say? Go into detail.
Oh, my God. No. It was like she's
tell
ugly
us everything.
And old.
I'd also like to add that this is
she was too pretty, right?
This is like the sexiest we've ever seen Rita Repulsa, I'd like to say. Honestly, I personally think, and I think that's dope. I think the aesthetic, everything just goes together so well. So I thought it was sick.
Yeah, it's like, Rita Repulsa. Thank you. Hey.
Low key, can I get your number?
So we're frightened of her?
I'm so scared.
Did you feel pressure to either imitate or you, what was your approach in this person that was this character was already existent?
Yeah, well, this script is pretty different. The we conceived of the character, I think, in a really modern way. From she was so campy in the past. I loved the Rita Repulsa in Mighty Morphin Power Rangers, etc. Because she's so larger than life, and she's sort of insane, and she's got this crazy laugh. And I wanted to preserve some of that energy in the character, but also we deal with what was on the page in front of me. And I also thought it was really important that these guys felt like they were up against real stakes, that she really was threatening and didn't give a flying crap about them or humanity, Earth, cars, their parents. Like, none of this makes any sense to her. She's an alien. She's 65 million years old.
She also, I got to give Elizabeth huge props. She learned that language, which she fully could speak. Was it?
Altarian.
I had to do it phonetically, and I could not do it. And then the whole time, Dean was like, you know, Elizabeth, you know, she learned this. I was like, come on, man. And then I watch a scene of her, and I'm like, gosh, she did it, and she's really good. It's like a second, it's like a first language. Wow. It's like your friend, man. That was amazing. That was really, hard.
I Skyped with a woman who created our language.
Correct.
Whose entire job was to come up with a fake language.
Bill didn't Skype with her.
Bill didn't Skype with her.
No.
Wow. Yeah. I just said, gosh, if I don't get this right, someone from that planet might be in the audience and be angry.
I'll be honest, I only did it because I was told, and this might not be true, that Brian Cranston learned the language.
Well, Brian and I were both. Brian and I were doing it phonetically, and it did not sound the way you did it. So that was really awesome. I don't know how you did that.
Hello, Seamus Kelly, Den of Geek, and I have been a fan since the beginning, watched every single episode, all 24 years, love it to death. One of the great things about Power Rangers is, of course, its diversity, and this movie continues that, but also in new ways, in that they have characters that are not just, you know, different colors of skin, but they also have someone who, as the movie says, is on the spectrum, which I loved, and they also had someone who's possibly questioning their sexuality, question mark?
Question mark?
From the actors involved in that, and also the director and writer, and sort of taking that whole big, bold step, because that's something that fans have wanted for so long, and it hasn't happened in the show. So what was the inspiration to go with that, and what was it like playing that as well?
Do you want to go first, RJ, or me?
Well, I guess so. It was exciting to be able to play a character that was on the spectrum, mostly because it challenged me to learn about something that I had no idea about, right? So it was like starting school over again, kind of. And it also, it kind of rekindled a friendship from my high school years, right? So I called my friend Andre to get like an insight, because Andre's on the spectrum, but he's one of the most brilliant minds that I've ever came in contact with, right? So it was like really cool to be able to step into that world and do that role justice, right? Because it's like, it's something that a lot of people don't understand, but we're all affected by it some way, you know? Mm-hmm. And so it's like, that's cool, you know, just to like be able to show how the world reacts to people that are on the spectrum, and also how people that are on the spectrum react to the world, yeah.
I personally, as a new actress, I want to be very aware of what messages I'm taking on and what character this message is carrying. And I feel like this movie is so diverse in so many ways. I mean, first off, the colors of our skins and where we come from is very different, and that isn't even mentioned in the movie because it doesn't matter, and we're all equal, and I think that's amazing. And not only that, we're diverse as far as genders go. You have two, you know, female leads in the Power Rangers who are working with three male leads, and we say together we are more. Without one, we're not the same. And I think that's awesome as well, being obviously all about that girl power. I think it's awesome to know that there's going to be young women watching this and say, hey, she looks like me, or I could do that too. And then as far as Trini and her identity issues, as far as her figuring out who she is, I think that's something very relevant and very current to our generation. I mean, we deal with self-identity issues, cyberbullying. You know, Billy being on the spectrum actually has a special place in my heart. My little brother Alex was diagnosed with autism at a very young age. And to know that he's going to watch this movie and he's going to be like, that's me, you know? And he can identify himself in that character is like all we can ask for as people to share a positive message like that. And I think we need that right now more than ever, for sure. So it's truly an honor to be a part of all of this.
Yeah, I'm Jerome Bay of Philadelphia Daily News. Just want to say, I had never seen the Power Rangers before, and I had a blast. Oh. This is fantastic. And to me, this is like Breakfast Club 2017. So I guess the question is, I mean, you could all be cliches if you wanted to be. Mm. How, especially for Naomi and Becky, how did you, or when you read that, how did you want to make that different and make the character your own?
Oh, why especially for us? Well, because what?
Because we're girls.
Oh, okay. sorry, I was just confused. Sadly. Yeah, I guess like the pink Power Ranger, you kind of think, you know, this kind of, I don't know, valley girl. I don't know what comes to mind, but for me, like, my responsibility is just to do the character justice. And when I got the script, I was like, okay, who is Kimberly and what's she going through? And she's not perfect. I mean, she does something that she regrets, but it's kind of how does she learn from that mistake? I mean, these aren't perfect kids, as we've said. They're all going through things. And I think that, that's kind of, I guess that's how I view it. I just want to do the character justice. And it's how she learns from her mistakes rather than just being one thing. I mean, we're not all one stereotype, you know?
Yeah.
We have like different layers going on. Yeah, I don't know.
Yeah, I mean, something as somebody who worked with your character, building Trini actually had a lot to do with talking with Nay and seeing how she was building Kimberly. And one thing that we always talked about was the sisterhood and how do we make that real? And how do we also not make it seem like we're pit against each other? Because two women can be successful in one thing. It doesn't have to be one better than the other or one prettier than the other or, you know, one cooler than the other. And I loved the contrast between our two characters and how they still, at the end, come together. And especially as young women, I think that's how we kind of broke down that barrier, because you have the total outsider and then you have the queen bee, you know? And
knocked off her pedestal.
Yeah. Yeah.
Hi, I have a question for all the Rangers. Is there a message that you hope kids get from the movie?
I do hope a lot of young kids go and see this movie. And I hope that they, you know, feel what I felt when I watched superheroes on screen as a kid. And I hope that they, through this movie, they get something more. And the most important message I want them to get is that it's okay to be yourself. Your imperfections are the things that make you unique, and it's the things that make you stand out. And as long as you find people around you that are good, that accept you for your imperfections and accept you for yourself, you guys can get together and do something better.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, that was
lovely.
Really good.
Wow.
Amen. He really landed that question.
He
landed it.
You stuck the landing.
Man, he stuck the landing on that.
My question for front row actors, the two questions. One question is detention, the bully, is a high school drama. It's really interesting, and I'm watching you guys dealing with. So how about yourself? Is there any best school days memory and the worst school days memory?
Oh, she's trying to get the good stuff.
Oh, boy, she is.
Dang, that hurts. I think... All right, my best high school moment had to be my 10th grade talent show, to be honest. That was the first time that I felt like I was going to get out of the friend zone. But then the worst day was probably...
Great.
The worst day was probably the next day when I found out that doesn't exist. Being out of the friend zone. So, you brung that out of me. I'm going to go cry now.
I kind of enjoyed school. I mean... I did have a little moment where I feel like everyone's been in that moment where you're like, you know, when that one friend isn't at school that day and so you don't really have anyone to hang around with. So you like walk around at lunchtime, like purposefully, but you're not going anywhere. So you're like, because you have no one to hang out with,
you just
want to
look cool.
You're walking around, but you have to look like you're going somewhere. I've been there a few times. I guess because I was always like in drama club or like in doing music. Sometimes like I wasn't, I was friends with everyone, but didn't like have like a clique. But yeah, I don't know. Other than that, I had a few of those moments, but other than that, it was pretty good. I liked high school.
What about you?
Everything worked out.
Everything was alright.
Now I'm famous.
And now I'm a Power Ranger, so I mean, it all kind of just flowed.
Dacre.
No speed bumps.
Okay. Are we moving on to the? You want to?
Yeah, I don't know. My experience in school was very different. I didn't really have many friends, and I was pretty overweight, and aww. I just wasn't. I guess when you first meet Jason at the beginning of the film, you're like, you know, it's just the stereotypical jock, and I think that's what's so lovely about it is that it doesn't evolve that way. And I hope that I was able to mold my own experience to that and give him more, you know, make him more multifaceted, multidimensional. And interesting to watch, you know, so that people hopefully fall in love with him. And, you know, he's seeking a relationship with the other, you know, the people in the different social cliques, if you want to call it that. In the school. Cliques. Cliques.
No, we say cliques, you know. Cliques. Crews.
Yeah, man, we say cliques out here in America, dude.
I'm learning.
Yeah, I don't know what you're all talking about, but it's cliques.
It's cute.
Aussies and English.
Maybe clique, yeah. Clique is
awesome. Do you say clique or click?
Click.
Me okay, personally, good. My school click. Experience, I'm...
She just took it.
Clique.
My school experience wasn't always the best. I actually wouldn't say I had like the greatest day. There wasn't like a day that sticks out that I was like, wow, that was really cool. Just because I guess the best way to explain it was like, I'm in a classroom filled with like monkeys and I'm a fish. And the lesson of the day was how to climb a tree. And I could see it. I could see it. And I knew how to climb it. And I could tell the teacher, this is how you do it. But I just couldn't do it. And everyone else is climbing the tree. And the teacher was like, why aren't you climbing the tree? And it's like, because I'm a swimmer. I'm really good at swimming. I'm just going to keep swimming, you know, because I'm really good at it. And I would always change schools. And I actually was always the new girl. And that was something that I talked about a lot with Dean, because I think a lot of people kind of maybe expected me to play like a Kimberly Hart, you know, the girly girl, because I am in real life a girly girl. But on a soul level, as far as like knowing what it's like to feel alone, I connected to Trini with that. So I definitely took a lot of like my childhood experiences from school and kind of like it kind of channeled with that whole thing. So yeah, it was pretty shitty. To be honest.
Hello.
Oh, hi.
I think for me, high school is like kind of for a lot of people, it's just bittersweet. I moved around a lot, so I was the outsider a lot of times, and that's how I connected to Zack, because he's kind of an outsider.
Hi, Erica Corbin, Screen Picks. This question's for Bill. I was wondering, I know our Rangers and even Rita, they got to don this cool armor and kind of getting
you guys don't have to look at it. Heckle me like I've been heckling you guys all.
And I was was just wondering, what are the challenges or even the creative, you know, leeway you got from playing a character that doesn't actually, you know, you don't physically appear on screen. You're this little robot.
Well, I've run out of voices, so I just did my own voice. And he's really excited. He's been waiting for a long time. And to be honest, I'm being totally honest. I watched these guys acting. I watched their act, and it was just like we were in a scene together. You know, you're watching what they're doing, and you're just reacting to what they were doing. And they're really good. They're really, really great. And I just kept saying that to Dean. There's probably tons of audio of me in the middle of a thing going, "God, that was good. Oh, that was great." Yeah.
I thought you were talking about your performance.
No. Oh. Yeah. Aren't I fantastic? No, they were really good. I mean, it was really, it would have, I've done a lot of animation, I've done a lot of these things, and it is hard when you're kind of just in a little room and they're going, okay, so it's a spaceship and there's this and that, whatever. But getting to watch these guys, it made it really easy.
Thanks, man.
Storybridge Girl TV. This question is for John. John, this is a great film. Everybody was great. I really loved it. You did such a great job writing the screenplay. And my question for you is about the relationships with the teenagers. Where did you come with all the inspiration? Is this experiences from your background, growing up? It was just brilliant. So I just want to hear a little bit about that.
Thank you. I was not in Ludi's clique, just to put that out there. But I was sitting here thinking that I can't stop thinking about
Ludi's
clique.
When he was a kid, he found these coins.
No, I was actually sitting here thinking about these guys because we're like the elders up here and like the young, beautiful people are sitting in front of us. And, you know, the first teenage movie that I worked on was Varsity Blues. And that was another movie where, thank you, where we had this, you know, collection of kids. You have to kind of find each other and, you know, overcome the obstacles and things like that. And so I think Dean and I, in trying to come up with these characters, we wanted to reflect kind of what the world would be today. And somebody else referenced Breakfast Club, which is an amazing movie from my youth that I loved. And what would those issues and what would those characters be today? You know, it's like, what would they be facing? So the ideas that these guys have already talked about were things we wanted to kind of bake into like what we were trying to represent today, you know? So.
So this is for Dean and John. Again, coming at this from like a fanboy perspective, is that this movie is very clearly taking some inspiration from the very first episode of the show, Day of the Dumpster, and then there's a lot of little references. How did you balance wanting to have those references for the fans and also wanting to have a good movie for the general audience and not get too bogged down in those references?
Right.
I mean, I guess it was all just about conceptually, did it fit into the movie? So if there was a reason for it and there was sort of a philosophy behind it, I think we felt like then it would be germane to the movie. And for all of those fans that would get those references, it would mean a lot. And for everyone else, it still feels organic to whatever's going on, so it won't bump you out of the movie. I think that was kind of the way we approached things like that.
Yeah, we definitely wanted to honor all of the things that the fans have enjoyed for so many years. But we obviously, you know, like Dean says, there's Easter eggs in there. And I know you're nodding going like, yeah, I saw that and I saw that and I saw that, which is great because there'll be a younger set that won't totally get that yet, but may get invited back into it. So we wanted to definitely honor that.
Yes, this is, am I on?
Yes, you are.
We got you, Rich.
This is for Elizabeth. Like I told you earlier, I'm still getting over you as Effie in the Hunger Games because of those fabulous outfits. Now you're dressed up in this one as well. The question is, does the outfit have a psychological effect on your performance?
Oh yeah, of course, for sure it does. All of the hair, the makeup, I wear prosthetics in this movie as well, which I've never done before, and may never do again. it changes your whole. You know, I like to sleep in the makeup chair, so because I'm there for 4 hours. So, but when I wake up and I look in the mirror, it's a totally different person sitting there. It's like, I never feel like the character until I'm walking in their boots and like carrying the staff, and all of it changes your body language and how you're perceived in the world.